ओम गुरुभ्यो नमः। ओम गणपते नमः। ओम श्री परदेवताये नमः। दिस इज जितेश सत्यन डूइंग दिस वीडियो फॉर श्री विद्या तंत्रम व्हाट्सएप ग्रुप। दिस इज एन इंट्रोडक्टरी वीडियो वेयर वी लुक इनटू द सन मून एंड फायर पाथ। We'll, as I mentioned, this being introductory, we'll just look at some of the tips and practices to experience it. We'll cover more videos in this series with specific asanas, specific breathing exercises, specific focus points, both internal and external, by which you can control these flows as well. So, Idanadi, or the moon path, is corresponding to the cold cycles in the body, and Pingala Nadi or sun path is associated to the hot or warm cycles in the body. So for example, if you are actually breathing, continuously breathing through your right nostril, forced closure of the left nostril, and then try to breathe through the right nostril, you will find that the body heats up and you feel more sweating. While when you are doing a forced breathing through your left nostril, then you will find a more cooling sensation that is brought in the body. And then there is a nostril when both noses are dominant, where there is an equal flow or almost equal flow, which is the neutral current. In this series, we will specifically look into sun, moon and fire path. And when we look at the fire path, in this series, we'll look at both noses being equally dominant. But fire path has additional things to it, like Kevala Kumbhaka, or where it's internal breathing. So we'll have a separate series covering spinal breathing and factors associated to that, multiple techniques like Hamsa Vidya, Vasi Yoga, Jyoti Yoga, all this being associated to internal spinal breathing. So that's a different series, because it requires a specific set of exercises and importance to that, including Shat Chakras. But this series will focus on Ida, Pingala and Sushumna. Sushumna being both nostrils being equally long. Now, so as part of this particular discussion, you will come to terms like Nadi, Chakra, Prana. Let's try to understand what it is. When I move my hand, this is the physical activity. However, there is a message from the brain, which we call a thought in the mind, which brings about this physical activity. And the translation of this thought as impulses in order to bring about this physical action involves an energy as well. So physical activity, thought, connection is energy. This is the energy or life force associated to prana. So this is what we call as prana. Prana has multiple variations. There is panja prana, then there is upa prana, which actually translates to dasa prana, and then we have a lot of focus that can be given again as a separate playlist on how to understand and work with the different pranas. So that is prana. Now, in order to have this transmission, there is an energy channel that should be available, an energy circuit that should make this happen. This is called Nadi. Nadi is the transmission channel through which energy can move. And points where there are multiple Nadis intersect is focus points where there will be more energy concentration, that is called chakras. So, very important points to be noted. Prana is not breathing. Swasa, prashwasa, and those are breathing. When you actually call prana science, prana shastra, prana vidya as just breathing, it just shows you have no clue about what is prana. Puraga, Reja, Kumbhaka also has different significance, and when you actually handle it, when you actually look at it from prana perspective. Now, even from this prana, when you look at how it works for the nadis, and chakras, you'll find that nadi again is not nerves, and chakra is not physical points which you can find. You can say it as navel, heart, but it's not actual points or actual physical parts that you can identify in the body. People usually connect it to specific glands and say it is the gland or a physical part in the body, which it is not. You don't have to always consider everything on the physical side. So there's a physical side. You understand there is the mind or a thought, though the physical part that handles it is the brain. So connecting this, we also understand there is energy, and that's where the connection brings in between prana, nadi, and chakras. So I hope you got some level of understanding in terms of what are the general concepts which people discuss and how different it is from breathing. Breathing being, of course, significant from a prana perspective, because it is one of the switches by which you can control prana. We'll see multiple switches in this video itself by which you can control the heat and cold cycles in the body, or idha and pingala. Okay, now coming to tantra. So, a feeling of ananda or ecstasy or out of body experience, or where you are not consciously aware, is considered as a heightened state of ananda, which is kind of the goal in tantra. This is more a trance state where you are not conscious about what is happening, but you still experience it. There are multiple examples that you can cite of these kind of trances. So it could be when you are in a movie hall watching a movie, you get into environmental hypnosis. You get into what is happening on the screen, and you are able to relate to it. You may probably cry. You might feel happy about events happening in the movie. So you are not actually thinking about you are in a movie hall or a movie. So at that point, you are not awake. You are awake, but it's a different state of awake. So it's not jagrat. So you are not fully aware that this is surrounding, this is a movie. You are not in a dream as well, and you are not sleeping as well. So that is one example. Similar examples you can take when you are driving and suddenly you realize that you have been driving for some long and you are not consciously driving. So this is another kind of environmental hypnosis. Now, these kind of trance states can be induced by multiple means. It could be based on japa. It can be based on specific breathings, like when you try to block oxygen for a higher duration, or it could be related to specific body postures. It could be combination of these. All these can activate trance state. You can also experience it when you are actually having maybe a major fall, a major life event, or a lot of instances you can actually come in. Suddenly you get something which makes you really happy, or somebody shaking your head or having specific movements of the body. All these can actually put you in a state which actually leaves your conscious awareness and puts you in control of the subconscious, or a state beyond jagrat, sopna, and sushupti. Because each of these states, from a technical perspective, the earlier scriptures have tried to differentiate that jagrat itself as jagrat, jagrat sopna, jagrat sushupti, and all those kind of. So there are substates within these states which causes the trance. And so ananda is also multiple levels of ananda. Out of body experiences, when you have a sudden accident, all these are different variations of ananda. But the issue with this is, it is uncontrolled, in that you don't have any control in terms of getting that particular ananda by able to repeat that process. So tantra makes it repeatable by control. So you know the specific steps that can actually bring you the same effect that is caused, that brings you to a specific state. And what happens at a physical level? Of course, there is specific gland secretions, there is specific pulse rate change, heart rate associated changes, sensation changes that happen in the body. So that is a byproduct. It's not like, okay, you focus on this chakra and suddenly something happens. Unless you practice and your body is able to repeat, that's when it becomes how it can be controlled. So then you should not directly map it to a specific gland or a specific body part. So Tantra is about control. It's not about letting loose of the mind. Mantra is about controlling the mind, and Tantra is about control of the body. So Mantra being a very important part of Tantra, because the whole body meaning not just the physical body but also the mind. So that's about Tantra. It's about gaining control. It's about understanding your own self at multiple levels: physical body, internal, subtle, and causal, and of course your inner self. And what is the benefit? Let's actually look at the specific point of Nadi. So when you there are multiple research that you can find in the internet. If you search for unilateral forced nostril breathing, you'll find that when you breathe through one nose, let's say the right nose or the left nose, it actually brings in changes in the pulse rate, it changes the heart rate, it changes, it even has a direct effect on the cognitive functions. So if you do a search, you will understand how much your body is related in terms of one controlling, which can actually bring in a lot of changes in the body. And I gave an example of cognitive functions as well. So you can actually see that both physical as well as emotional effect it will have in terms of unilateral forced nostril breathing. But what it is actually doing is, it is actually changing the heat or the cold currents in the body, which brings about this change. So with Tantra, you will be able to have better control on the body, which means you will be able to know much before you get sick, even small changes, because you are well aligned to your body rhythm. You understand any minute changes in the body, and you can actually, with control on the heat and cold currents, you will be able to ensure that there is proper digestion, there is proper elimination of food waste. You actually have a healthy body, and you get connected to much connected to nature as well. So as I mentioned, there is also an emotional and physical, emotional and mental change that actually brings in. When you get more connected to the body, you realize that nature can crush you like an ant at any moment. So that the understanding of death brings you more appreciation to life. So every day is actually taken as a gift. So you try to enjoy life in terms of understanding it and appreciating it. So if it is Tantra, then it's about control. It's not about letting your mind loose by playing a music or doing some dance. If you are able to get it repeated, repeatable change, which is perfectly getting your body into control, then of course it has an aspect to Tantra, because Tantra has some connections which is associated to whether it is sex or dance or songs. All those things have associations. As I mentioned, sound can actually bring in specific trance. And it's not just about when you say about sex, even if you want to control your ejaculation, it's not, it would require specific mudras, specific focus on specific regions in order to actually do that. So it's not just, if somebody says that if you ejaculate multiple times a day and that is Tantra, because you are now gaining, now because the body part is weak or your whole body is weak, you lose your interest in sex, that person has no clue of Tantra. Even to actually control sex, there's a lot of effort and practice that is required, after which it would be much easier. So that's about Tantra, Nadi, Prana and Chakra. Just a high level overview. And if you search on multiple studies that has been done on in terms of breathing exercises and some of the yoga based postures, you will understand this relation, what I'm trying to say. Okay. So enough of theory, we'll try to check out some practicals. This being, as I mentioned, in this playlist we'll have videos on specific asanas that can bring in changes in the dominant nostril. So as well as specific breathing, specific internal focus and specific external focus that can help. So we all know that if we lie on while you are sleeping or while you are going to sleep in the bed, when you actually lie on your sides, that can actually switch the nose which is dominant, or if you have a closed nose, then you can actually bring the closed, it would actually switch to the other one by lying on a specific side of your body. So how to know the dominant nose? As a beginner, the method would be, you might feel like both your nose are open, but if you breathe out through both nose, you will actually find that one is more open compared to the other, by which you can understand the dominant nose. Another method, once with practice, you can even blow to the upper surface of your hand, by which you can know whether it is the right, left side or your right side which is more dominant. There are multiple things associated with that. By movement, you can understand which tattva is dominant in the body and stuff. But again, understand which is the dominant nose. So one we mentioned about lying on a specific side. Now, yoga danda is quite popular in terms of switching nose. So if you keep the yoga danda on your left side, then you will see the dominant nose switching to the other side, which is the right for me. Now, normally the switch happens. The body cycle itself, as part of the body cycle itself, it usually switches every 2-2.5 hours, as well as activities done by the body. But with yoga danda, you will be able to do it much faster. Probably for a beginner, it would be 5-10 minutes for that matter. You will be able to see the switch. So let's say you start and you find that your left nose is dominant, and then when you keep the yoga danda in your left armpit, then the right nose will become dominant. So this is one method to change dominance, and you can change dominance with practice very easily. So in this video series, I will also show that with probably putting a cello tape above my nose, I can show that you can breathe in through one nose and immediately change the dominant nostril and have the exhale through the other nose. So switching off nostril can be done even in a single breath cycle itself. That's possible with practice. When we come to the internal and external focus, we'll cover that in detail. So this is one. Now, it can be kept slightly moved from the armpit. Another pose. This is another one, and this is the next. So when I actually move the yoga danda, this needs to be done and practiced, only then you will understand the differences. So in your nose, near the bone, if you keep your hands and try to blow, exhale out, you will find that you will be able to, just like a valve, you will be able to control the airflow. So it's like controlled flow through each of the nose. The same thing can be achieved in terms of control flow. So you want to keep one nose dominant and again control the flow in the dominant nostril or the other nostril. This can be done using the yoga danda. So that you can actually experience. So this flow, when you keep here, is quite different from the flow that you will get in this posture for, after sitting in this posture for 5-10 minutes, is different from what you will get when it is here. So when I say here, it is not at the edge, it is the region which where Ayurveda doctors check your pulse with a 3-finger reed. So it's slightly moved. It's not directly here. It's not here. It's slightly backwards. Try it here. How it brings in change. Try it slightly here as well as you can try it here. So you will be able to see how regulated control can be achieved using the yoga danda. So this is hand where you are actually trying to bring in this change. And the one here is usually used in japa for more longer term meditations. This pose is used where you don't have to do a japa with a necklace or a necklace with beads. So this one is used. This has specific purpose, because when you actually practice, you will understand how it can have effect in terms of control flow. So based on the day or specific dominance in your posture as well. So if you want to regulate it after a specific time when you are not specifically focused on your breathing, then it will try to switch to its normal state. And this can be again regulated back using keeping it in a different position. So this is one. It's not just the hands that you can use. Even the legs can be used in order to regulate. So again, something you can try out. When the leg is pushed towards the bone region and then you place, so this is the blocked, this region becomes active, okay, or the leg which is on top, this is the leg that is on top, that side is active. So it's a left leg, so the left side is active. The right leg is below, so the left leg is pushed onto the right side, on the thigh, above the thigh and towards the bone. So this will bring in an effect similar to what you did here. Now again, regulated flow that we tried with keeping the yoga danda in different positions can be experienced instead of keeping it on the thigh. If you keep it here, then the second level can be experienced. So instead of keeping on the thigh, now it's on the next lower part of the leg that I'm keeping. This for meditation versus this versus another third variation similar to yoga danda you can do with the siddhasana. Again, being a very popular posture for japa, similar to keeping the yoga danda in the hand. So three specific levels here. Okay. So we saw how it can be altered in the hand, altered in the legs. Now it's all these are trigger points, as I mentioned. So it's not the dominant nostril is currently being used as just a tool to identify whether it is the hot current or the cold current or the neutral current that is being activated. So based on that, you will be able to identify. As I mentioned initially, you can try with just breathing through the right nostril, then you will understand what the heat current is. When you try through the left nostril, you will understand what the left cold current is, or the Ida and Pingala. And then you can actually look at how different points, even this, so first one was forced nostril breathing, which actually changed the current. Then it was hand yoga danda based techniques which actually changed the current. And then it was leg postures that actually changed the current. And we are using the dominant nostril as a measure to identify which current is dominant. Now, from an understanding perspective, it's not just these things that are involved. So, this is basically just the foundation of yoga and tantra. For example, whenever you are doing a Surya Namaskara or Ashva Sanjana Asana, for that matter, let's say, understanding the difference between keeping the right leg forward in order to do versus keeping the left leg forward is something to be understood with practice. So this was just to show that from a yoga perspective, you will need to, that's why it is said that every asana needs to be held for at least a period of time in order to see the specific activities it brings in on the body, whether it is on breathing, whether it is on hot, cold, whether it is on your pulse rate, which body points get stretched, how it actually helps in digestion, all this needs to be studied, otherwise it would just be an exercise, as in like a stretch for the body, just an exercise for the body. It never gets converted to yoga, where you are able to gain control on the mind-body complex. you are able to connect your body with the mind, and you are able to control the different activities in the body. So nadi, knowledge of nadi, knowledge of prana, and all the, if you look at any of the ancient scriptures, this gets discussed before getting into the asana practices and details on how to work with asanas and prana and other stuff. So nadi knowledge is kind of preliminary. We just consider the three nadis, but there are a lot of different nadis which you can actually work with in terms of working next to the eyes, near the central region, just below the rib cage, all those stuff. So we can actually have a separate video when we cover prana and nadis, where we cover these kind of details. Okay, so that was the basic of from Hatha Yoga, Hatha Yoga, or Yoga perspective, where each asana becomes significant when it is not limited to just a stretch exercise, but you stay in that asana to see the difference. And then you will understand why Surya Namaskara needs to be done in a specific way, or why Ashvasanjalina Asana needs to be done, whether it is on the right leg forward, right leg bent, or the left leg forward. What difference does it actually bring up in your overall exercise? And does it really activate my my Surya Nadi? Is it directly having an effect on my Pingala Nadi or the Surya path? And then that actually brings control on how you can actually get into the details. Now, Tantra is also has a lot of significance in Nadi, Prana. Otherwise, Mantra just becomes more of an auto-suggestion for mental peace. So you keep repeating a mantra. All you are doing is actually aligning to it and getting a specific mental peace from it, as a suggestion that it is going to bring you happiness, you are going to have this effect. And the self-suggestion really helps. So I won't say that it is not beneficial, but true mantra and tantra sadhana will require knowledge of nadi, prana, chakras, not just as imagination. If you say white light, yellow light, red light, yellow bindu, red bindu, and all those stuff, it's just going to be imagination. And in order to relate to the videos that I'm going to share, you'll have to listen to it completely from an understanding perspective. Because in Mooladhara Vidya, which I shared, I mentioned about Shanmukhi Mudra, where you close the eyes, nose, mouth, ears. And the reason why that was shared, after a specific pranayama and a specific posture, it was actually shared so that it becomes easy for the person to see the, what is the inner vision can be seen after withdrawal of senses. So to a beginner, if I say after doing this particular pranayama, withdraw your senses and see what is the inner color that manifests, it would be hard for that person to do it. That's why I mentioned about Shanmukhi Mudra. After doing this pranayama in Vajrasana, then with this particular mantra, then use Shanmukhi Mudra to see the inner vision. But rather than after going through a full video, the person is a person who is aspirant, who is wants to try it out, does not take the pressure, the effort in terms of doing all this. All he does is he will just close the eyes using Shanmukhi, eyes, nose, and all using Shanmukhi, and say like, I am not seeing the same vision, or I am not seeing even anything closely related to it. And probably then the person will have questions like, based on different lighting conditions, I am seeing different light colors, based on specific different scenarios, I am seeing different colors, which is quite true. The purpose of Shanmukhi Mudra is, Shanmukhi Mudra sadhana itself is there, which is related to a specific chakra, and in terms of color changes and all, is there with Shanmukhi Mudra. But the reason why we incorporated it in Mooladhara Vidya was just as a tool to identify what is the inner vision that comes from withdrawal of senses. So we used it only for withdrawal, forced withdrawal of senses. And it was not to experiment without doing the full effort. So in order to actually understand whatever I discussed in this video also, you will have to put effort. If you just keep the Yoga Danda for a minute and say it's not changing, it may not change for you, because there are different exercises to be done in order to expedite this switch and gain control and experience what changes happens in the body. There are different Nadi Shuddhi techniques. There are different techniques in terms of cleansing, not just the nadis, which will help you to expedite it. If you have queries, I'll be happy to answer. So you have my number in this video. You can drop me a note in WhatsApp and I'll be happy to answer. I also have weekend sessions where if you where more systematic handling of these kind of yoga techniques, Tantra yoga is done. But again, these are free sessions, but again, it's not mandatory. Whatever I will be sharing in these videos will give at least a high level, though it will not have a sequential procedure-oriented way of achieving everything. But still, if you are alert to this, if you have been practicing these kind of things and if you have patience, even from the videos, you will be able to pick up and improve and understand the real essence of Tantra and Yoga. So I hope you will experiment with the things that I cover. And this is not just about hand and leg. Another important point that came just now to my mind is another switching point. So when you are actually keeping the yoga danda here, or when you are applying pressure in this region, this is a marma point or varma point. In there's something called varmakala or strategic points in the body. So pressure, again, there are research studies as well on the same. When you actually look for forced unilateral nostril breathing, you will find information about this as well. Though they are not calling it varma because it being English publications, of course the focus is on specific body parts. So pressure in this region, even when you are putting the yoga danda here, you are getting pressure in this region. So pressure in this region also switches the dominant nostril as the other side. However, if you, let's say, so when I have the yoga danda here, the nostril, dominant nostril is this. However, if I put pressure on this side, like let's say I'm meditating this way and I put pressure on this side of my neck, then the dominant nostril is the same side. So the from a neck region perspective, when you put pressure, it is the same side. But when it comes to this region, the heart region, it is on the opposite side. So then you will understand how the nadi drawings and all, which is there in a lot of scriptures and drawings, where it goes from here. So let's say the right side, the pingala nadi, it will go from here till here. From all this region is on the right. Then it is shown like this to the heart region. So it's shown as curve, just like the snake. It is actually shown, Ida Nadi and Pingala Nadi is shown from here, from Ajna to Vishuddhi, Vishuddhi to Anahata. So that you can directly relate now. From an internal experience perspective, you can understand that as we progress. But even from a physical level, you can understand how the pressure here will make this nose dominant, whereas the pressure here will also make this nose dominant, making a circuit which actually goes through this region and then comes through this region. So there are a lot of things that you can discover in terms of how the body really works, and understanding your body, understanding your whole body, not just your external physical body. So it's a journey. Tantra is a journey in terms of realizing yourself, and it's something to be experienced and not just imagined. Thanks for listening. Hope you will experiment the different techniques that were discussed in this video.